is dying to get out of here and get a beer. But so we'll try to keep it short, but I think we have about 45 minutes to an hour. So let me start by introducing myself. My name is Kunal Khattar. I run a fund, an early stage technology fund based out of Delhi. It's probably India's only fund focusing on mobility and transportation. We've been investing for about 3 years. So we have made significant investments in the area of shared mobility. What we realized very early on that shared mobility is going to be a very important and compelling disruption in the automotive slash two-wheeler space. But we also recognize that given India's unique, limited disposable incomes, two-wheelers is actually going to be the right form factor and not necessarily four-wheelers. So many of our portfolio companies are actually companies that are using two-wheelers to give cost-effective and efficient mobility solutions. Our largest investment is a company called Rapido, which is India's largest two-wheeler bike taxi company. We've also invested in companies in public transportation like Chalo and Shuttle. So that's enough about my fund. Before we start, I'd like to allow all our panelists members from different areas to introduce themselves so that you can get to know them a little better, starting with on my right-hand side.
Hello. So, hello, I'm Anubhav from Electorque. So, a company which was founded first by engineers, I'll say, who then turned into entrepreneurs. So, this company we founded was on a small fact that we witnessed. So, we did a small calculation and we realized that it takes a 1500 kg car to transport a man of less than 100 kgs. And that didn't make sense to us. So, we thought to come up with some innovative vehicles which are way too less in weight and other smart functionalities so that they can be used very readily in the shared mobility market that is coming up, so that easy to maintain and different features which will add on to it. So that's why we founded this company Electorque, and we are building some smart, innovative, lightweight vehicle solutions via this company. Yeah,
Ramashankar Pandey from Hela. Hela is, of course, in India, we are infamous for horns, so we make those noisy horns. But Hela is deeply into the area of environment and safety. In India, mostly, our vision is technology of tomorrow for the life of today, where we are basically talking about how do we reduce the road accidents with our efforts. Especially when we see more accidents happening to two-wheelers, roughly more than 100 plus people die every day. And the one involved is commercial vehicles, and there are a lot of differentiation we can bring. So our ambition or vision or desire is to actually reduce every avoidable road accident on the road. It's a difficult task, extremely difficult task, which also needs a lot of collaboration. So me being here is also one of the reason is to get people along on this topic and what can we do together. So I'm also looking forward from the panelists and maybe from the discussion to some action in the end if we can do it together. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Padmanabhan. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Vogo. Vogo is a two-wheeler shared mobility self-drive startup based out of Bangalore. We started 3 years back. For the last 1 year, we've been scaling very aggressively. We are present in 5 cities now, and hopefully in the next 1 year in most of the cities that you live in. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Ankit Kumar. I'm the Chief Strategy Officer of Yota. So Yota is a Singapore-based holding entity which has got operations in Taiwan as of now. And we are now looking at expanding our operations in India and other countries in Southeast Asia. So Yota is a ride-sharing platform which primarily works on electric mobility front only. Yota is backed by Ahmani, which is a 20-year-old company which makes electric scooters. And we work on the four fronts of electric scooter, where the technology plays a very vital role, and which is a bigger challenge in the ride-sharing platforms that we see. And that's where we try to combine both the USPs coming in line and try to run this entire platform.
Hi, everyone. My name is Amrit Chaudhary. I'm the managing director at Lightport. We are basically a startup in Dehradun, and we have a fleet of 10 vehicles running currently. We are doing a pilot there, and we are looking to bring, the electric mobility revolution to Uttarakhand, trying to tie up with, logistics partners in the beginning so that we can set up a big charging and, battery swapping network in the beginning. and later, you know, probably getting into the tourist market also.
Hi, my name is Arar Dasgupta. I'm the Chief Digital Advisor at Microsoft, and I focus primarily on automotive, transportation, logistics, and as well as agri and farm equipment. As much as farm equipment has not been given a space in the automotive world, I'd like to say that, you know, tractors are automotives at the end of the day. So that's what I do for a living. Yeah.
Thank you so much. So I'm going to have a bunch of questions. I'd like to, you know, allow any of the panelists to take the mic and answer. And if anybody wants to add to that, they're most welcome to do that. And after that, we'll be happy to throw it open to the audience for more questions. So how I'm going to do it is that let's start with a 40,000 foot view, much more from a macro level. We're talking about disruption in the overall industry and two-wheelers specifically. Disruption can happen in any form, whether it's in the electric vehicle side, or whether it's connectivity, telematics, whether it's product or solutions innovation, or it's in the areas of shared mobility. I guess I'd like to ask the question here, according to you, with regards to urban transportation, what do you think is going to be the biggest creator of disruption in the whole two-wheeler space? And what is the maximum disruption you see in which of these areas? And you're welcome to say the one that you're doing, but I'd like you to talk about other businesses.
Okay, sure. So see, what we believe, and this is based on what we have seen in the global market today. So as Armani has been selling into 26 different countries, we saw there is a big urge and there is a big decline in the asset ownership, which is going in India as well. You can see the latest automobile sales trends, how things have been happening here. So we see that asset ownership is something which the millennials and even further down line, you know, people are not willing to go forward with that. And that's where the shared mobility comes in place, which reduces on the congestion, which works on making EVs more affordable for the general public to utilize for the daily commute and for different other rental options which are there, which the delivery and the B2B segments can also utilize. So that's where we see, shared mobility making the future for mobility coming in line.
Yes, so from business model perspective, it's clear in not only in two-wheeler, but overall even in the four-wheeler space, that all these, you know, autonomous connectivity, shared electric, are the major trend where the disruption is happening. From my point of view, you know, we always hear innovation and disruption, two sides of the same coin, but the feelings are too different on this. And I was made in this confusion very clear in one of my experience in Silicon Valley, where somebody told me, if the entrepreneurs are coming and running for out of fear, something is, you know, they are going to lose their business, they call it disruption. And if they're coming with the greed that they will make it, it's the innovation. And any technology per se, and I think you rightly talked about a business model of sharing, which is actually a disruption. But we talk about a lot of technology as a disruption, which to me is not a disruption. What is more important, what the technology is going to do, the purpose. And the major trend in purpose has to be, and we are talking about the Indian context, and what is the need. So when we start with the need and we disrupt that, I think from a social point of view, that's more critical or acceptability. Either we are changing a social behavior or you're using a social behavior. So again, I'm coming back to the same topic, which is, you know, every day 400 people dying, or let's say 700 people dying as per WHO, cannot be left unattended. And I was very happy when you said that the biggest disruption he wants in the area of safety. Now, it is not a cool thing to talk about what can happen in safety. You know, as automotive fraternity, we are also pained on this as part of ACMA, SIAM, or CII. I think on the top level, and you talk about 40,000 feet level, everybody is committed to this. But when we go on a moment of truth, nothing is actually getting, you know, replicated what we want on the top. So if you ask the wish list, of course the wish list can be, how can we, with all the people and such a bright talent is now attracted towards automotive, if all the talent and all the technology can be converged to doing something at the moment of truth to solving this problem. The road deaths are only increasing, not decreasing. And two-wheeler also is the same. It's only increasing. And we are putting more and more two-wheeler under stress now. So if you look at the delivery segment, They are not like normal two-wheeler. They are under stress. They have a job to do. Unlike, you're under time pressure. In commercial vehicle, we used to see that. That people were under time pressure. But now even in two-wheeler, and two-wheeler is a dangerous, it's 17 times more dangerous than a car. In India, if you talk about the vulnerability. So this is what I wish it will happen, that everybody collaborate on that. That what can we make a difference on the moment of truth. If you talk about Hella per se as a company, we took out that as an example. We did a lot of things now on commercial vehicle side. You'll see a lot of change on roads. For example, basic thing. I think in India, we need basic things. 80% of the trucks will not have tail lights. And you know, it seems it is nothing, no deal. But people go inside the truck. Your airbag will not work. And you have families going inside and thousands and lakhs of these deaths. Simple thing, few hundred rupees more or maybe some innovation. We did that. Now you will see almost all trucks in next 1 or 2 years will come with LED 5 tail lights, which will be fit and forget. It's simple thing, but impact is huge. And the journey was not easy because for somebody to understand how it will impact took a lot of time for us. It took us 3, 4, 5, 7 years now for all the OEMs to get converted to this. Similarly, in two-wheeler, we see exactly this. On the two-wheeler, we see exactly this. We just got in the other panel that 35,000 people died due to potholes. And in two-wheeler, the stability is the biggest issue. And of course, now we have ABS, which is really a record for the country. When it comes to the looking at the two-wheeler potholes and falling because of that, the range of the lighting is very important.
So, absolutely. I think these are important points on safety. So, for Microsoft's point of view, which is an enabler, and from, if you had to look at it from that prism, would you like to add?
Yeah, so you are expecting a technological answer to that, but I'll stay away from that, and I'll just say that, you know, first of all, we got to disrupt our mindsets. Forget about technology disrupting anything. Technology is just an enabler. I'm an ex-biker until I lost my left hip, which is a replaced hip right now. I used to race. I've driven almost all kinds of bikes in my life. In my growing up years, I used to tinker with the bike. And I soon learned how to service it. I soon learned how to accessorize it. I would change things around, especially when you're preparing for races, you would strip down the bike, get the weight distribution right and all that. And that time we didn't have. So very funny thing happened. In 82, I'm talking about, we used to race in this old airstrip, Barakpur, near Kolkata. And at that time, there was no high octane fuel. So we found a source in the Air Force to sell us high octane airplane fuel in black. And we used to mix it in the night with normal petrol to get the right torque. Now, why am I saying this? This generation that I see wants to, so my daughter, who's 25, works with PricewaterCoopers, she never wants to own a vehicle, right? They invest in going for visiting a foreign country every year with all their scrounging their savings. They are not interested in house ownership. They are not interested in vehicle ownership. Right, but they would like to access to it. I mean, for the last 15 years, my family has lived off Uber and Ola and autos, the famous autos of Pune. And we are very, very happy about that. So this is a DIY generation. So I was talking to one of my friend, new friend, Mayank Jain. Mayank, I was saying, what does it take to assemble electric scooter? He said, nothing much. What if you sent CKDs out to customers and reduce your manufacturing costs, and ultimately they could go to a maker's area to get the maker's area could be a multi-brand area where multiple e-scooters could get assembled. You're providing for employment, you're providing an experience, right? And you're helping people get involved. Why do you think IKEA has invested in India and opened that huge store? Because we have such a mobile young generation, and over the weekends, instead of becoming couch potatoes and Netflix junkies, they want to do things on their own. So this is something you're not catching, that this generation is all about getting their hands dirty, doing things on their own. I see all our coders in Hyderabad and all of that doing that. So that's number one. And I think I want to leave the big players who are well-funded and they seem to be a pipeline of funding happening to the Olas and whoever else, right? But I think about the smaller players and people who are wanting to grow. And obviously, the connected experience is going to be a determinant. Look at the success of MG Hector. Look at the success of Hyundai Venue. Look at the success of Kia Seltos. Suddenly, they've come in, outright challengers in the market, not incumbents. And the incumbents are sitting there now looking and discussing what connected features they will have. So what I'm recommending as a disruptor is, why not, with a technology partner, create an open, connected two-wheeler platform where you could have multi-tenanted instances of smaller players and who can join hands. Or obviously, you'll have your own security, your own experiences. I'm happy to talk to five or six such e-scooter or e-motorcycle players who want to join hands and work with Microsoft to make that happen. So I think first, mindset disruption, I think. That's the main thing. We are not catching the right spots. We are not leveraging the huge latent desire of younger generation, Zillennials, as they call them, to do things on their own. Okay? And we are still trying to force them to own things. They will not. They will use, throw, use again. Right? That's the generation we are talking about.
Okay, thank you. It's very interesting. Thinking of moving away from a DIFM, which is do it for me, to a DIY mindset. I think that's an interesting way to go. Okay, changing gears a little bit. So we read about government regulations and changes that's coming about, especially in the area of introduction of EV. So, of course, sometimes it's two steps forward, one step back. So assuming that you had to pick one government policy which you think is going to be beneficial, or if you want to give one message to the government, what would that be to help the industry as a whole? And you can be a little controversial, that's okay.
So as a technology player, I know, and I know you will be far more experienced to comment on this. But I think this government policy about only giving subsidies to commercial operators of e-vehicles is going to be detrimental to the growth of electrification of the industry. Electrification, I think, India as a nation is trying to take a jump start. We rode across hybrid, we are not going to, and we are jumping straight onto electric. So from that point of view, I think you should also encourage, the government should also encourage personal ownership of electric vehicles, especially e-scooters, if you ask me. And not just restrict it to, you know, only fleet operators. Hum bhi kuch kar sakte hain. Hamara bhi ichha hai, right? So that's the way it is.
I'd like to add to that, as far as two-wheelers are concerned, I believe the government is also offering swaps to individual, you know, two-wheeler owners who are looking at purchasing, you know, electric scooters as such. The swaps do not extend to those people who are looking at purchasing four-wheelers.
You'll have to hold it closer.
Okay. So, the swaps don't extend to those people who are looking to purchase probably electric four-wheelers. But the subsidies are still there for individual, you know, customers of electric scooters as such. And the government is going in the right direction regards to that. There is this drop in GST percentage from 18 to 5. And spare batteries are still, you know, selling at 18% GST. And that is something that might change in the future. And but then there is also this, you know, possibility that a spare battery would be misused if you know, it is attracting a subsidy. So that's one thing that I'd.
But tell me something. I mean, the sense that individual subsidy, how much from an X price, the retail price?
Right. So basically, if the scooter is around, you know, a lakh of rupees, the price of it, and the subsidy is basically calculated on the battery capacity. So it will go up to around 10,000 rupees for 1 kilowatt hour of battery capacity, right?
So my take on this government policy and regulations for promoting electric is a bit different. I think the government has done a lot of things right now in terms of the FAME policies and GST reduction and bunch of other things as well. But I think the need of the hour, if the electrification has to happen faster and not over a 5-10 year period, but 2-3, you know, within the next 5 years, let us say that, I think the government has to look at ecosystem creation, right? So how do you create the ecosystem? Where does the power come from, right? Like, I mean, tomorrow we have, we have 20 crore two-wheelers in the country. India is a two-wheeler country, and more than 80% of all the vehicles in India are two-wheelers. So if tomorrow, if all of these vehicles are going to become electric, so where is the power going to come from? Right? I think because at the end of the day, if you say India does 70-80% of all of its power from coal, then you start importing more coal. I mean, where is renewable sources of energy coming from? Right? So then you start the ecosystem with how does the power come from? And start from there and say, okay, electrification starts from there. And then how do I electrify and get my two-wheelers? And then this entire two-wheeler, four-wheeler, fleet, commercial, all of this talk for me, you know, it has to be an ecosystem creation, right? So today, we sell more than 2 crores two-wheelers in a year. Hero, Honda, and TVS probably sell 80-85% of all of those numbers. So now you're saying that we will come and put two-wheelers which are electric in the market. And the two-wheelers that are available today in the market are not anywhere close to what the experience on an Activa is. That is the highest selling scooter. And also from a price point comparison, I mean, whatever you have things to say that from over a period of 5 years, it'll make sense, it does not make sense, because the average usage of every individual is not more than 7-8 kilometers a day. So the unit economics actually does not work. So then how do you make that vehicle, electric vehicle, at a comparative price to the petrol product over a period of their life? How do you ensure that there are charging swapping ecosystems which are probably fast charging? I mean, I'm talking about both personal and shared. Shared is probably easier because it's fleet operations. We can run it anywhere we want, and we'll probably share a lot of customers over a single vehicle, probably share 8 to 10 customers over a single vehicle in a day. So, I mean, the government has to look at the ecosystem in all, from power generation to how to electrify, and if electrification is done, how do you do a change management in terms of the existing OEMs changing over, the new OEMs coming in and introducing electric vehicles. If the existing OEMs are going to change over, I mean, there are thousands and thousands of dealerships in the country which are invested into servicing spares. I mean, I'm sure you know. I can see Kunal's smile. So I mean, thousands and thousands of crores are invested in the market for the last 20 years. I mean, I'm sure the return on investments will be there, but it's their livelihood at the end of the day. There are mechanics, thousands and thousands of mechanics who are, garage owners and individual mechanics, punk, like whatever, right? So all of these guys are sitting on the road, and you're saying that you're going to electrify. So what happens to that ecosystem? So it is an ecosystem play in large, and the government needs to think about from power generation till electrification, and how do you, ensure that everybody in the ecosystem does not get affected in the long run, and then not one part of the ecosystem is served for, but the entire ecosystem and value chain is maintained. And that would be my take on the policies that exist.
I think what we want from government, what we don't want is more important for us, is definitely, any disruption, if you fix it by technology, we don't know the final word in technology. So if you say, okay, EV or nothing, this is what we don't want. And I think that's why you see two step further and one step backward, because you want the complete ecosystem, as he was telling, to think about how do we disrupt the emission situation of the country. And that is why not only EV and nothing, but EV and other alternatives. So like you said, you want to jump plug-in hybrids, overall automotive, I think we should give chance to every technology, and the innovation should be flourishing by policies which is more enabling, not by cutting something. So you say, okay, 2022, you stop this, 2025, you stop that. It is basically curtailing any other innovation. So that is one. Second, because connected is something which is definitely benefiting even today, and everyone is aligned on that. Can we have a data policy which actually is bringing or enabling the open source working in the industry? Today it is not. Each one of us are working in isolation separately, and government can do a big role here. Forget about giving money. Give us a protocol. Give us a standard. Bring us together on the table. And then what we can create for the country will disrupt much larger or bigger than the short pills of 10,000 rupees or whatever.
I'd like to add one point to that. Like Mr. Dasgupta said, I believe it's more of a problem of, you know, change in or transformation in the mindset. Now, I'll give you an example. We are using, you know, Okinawa bikes in our, you know, fleet currently. So, when I ride that vehicle in Dehradun, I get a mileage of, 90 kilometers and my weight is like 100 kgs. Now, I'm talking about Dehradun, which has a lot of, you know, gradient roads, and if I were to, you know, probably use that vehicle in Gurgaon, I would probably get a mileage of around 100 kilometers. Now, this vehicle gets recharged, the battery, within 2 hours at my home. You know, I can actually remove the battery and I can carry it up to my apartment and, you know, charge it. So, and now that particular vehicle after the GST cut is coming to, an ex-showroom price of 72,000 rupees. And, even if it is 80,000 rupees on the road, I think it's still beating even an Activa in terms of, I could be, making money actually running that vehicle after just the first 20,000 kilometers. So this is how much the technology has already improved. And I can only see it going, further. Obviously, there are subsidies involved which are kind of skewing, the numbers in favor of the electric vehicle manufacturers. But those are the facts on the ground. So I think this transformation is what is, this mental transformation is what is more required. There is a lot of movement in the technology space, like Ankit and his company. I believe they are coming out with scooters for the Indian market, which will recharge themselves in 20 minutes from 0 to 100. So I think the technology is already there. It's more of a requirement for people to, change their mindset, go out, actually try the electric vehicles for themselves. We have taken them from Dehradun to Mussoorie, a continuous climb of, 45 minutes to 1 hour, and they perform. So,
great. Okay, thank you. I think you pretty much answered most of my future questions, but I'm going to have to just innovate here. Let's talk a little about, so we all recognize the importance of two-wheelers in the shared mobility space, whether it's personal mobility, shared mobility, delivery, etc. And we've seen rapid adoption in all those areas. If somebody would like to throw some light in terms of what are the key challenges here that we're facing for accelerating the adoption of use of two-wheelers for various last mile, first mile connectivity, shared mobility, delivery, etc.
See, before we reach there, the basic question is, what is the challenges with regards to electric two-wheelers today? So the four challenges that we see is one on the range anxiety. So the scooters are not able to go more than 50 kilometers, 60 kilometers in a single charge, unless you are using a 3 kilowatt, 4 kilowatt, and a higher capacity battery. The second challenge is that every 2.5-3 years, you have to invest into the capex, buying the battery again and again. So the life cycle of the battery is not more than 1,000 cycles, which comes to like 2.5 and 3 years. The third challenge which revolves around is the scooters that are being sold in India, except the likes of Ather. You know, these scooters, when you try to drive in areas which are very highly inclined and you try to go up the hill, these scooters do not perform that well because the credibility is very much low. So many of the scooters which are sold in India today works on a gradability of around 7 degrees. Ather works on 17 or 18 degrees. But there's a need to have disruption coming in these three domains, which is range anxiety, battery technology, so the battery life cycle is very high, and the third thing which I mentioned is on the gradability. Coming on the fourth part, where it's very much close to the range anxiety part. So the fourth part is how fast it could be charged. Or how you're going to disrupt that by adding in swapping stations or going for fast and quick charging, which certainly reduces the battery life cycle to a bit if you are using the fast charging regularly. So these are the four areas where the disruption needs to happen. And these are the four areas where we work on. So we have worked on these two areas, these four areas from last 15 years to come with battery solutions where the battery life cycle has been extended to 5,000 cycles. So The scooters that we are going to launch here are going to come with battery life cycle of 5,000, which is nearly around 10 to 12 years. You don't have to change the battery pack for 10 to 12 years, which even makes a great deal of sense for us in the ride-sharing community, that if we use those scooters where we have got to reduce on the initial cost that we have incurred, and over a period of time, you have ample of areas where you can innovate and try to reduce on the cost. Second is, we worked out the quick charging way, where we have a 0 to 95 in 20 minutes sort of a solution, which we are going to install. And the third thing on the gridability, which we worked out, is on a higher side, which is greater than 25 degrees. So, you know, these three, four areas are the key attributes for making any model a success. You can tweak around the sharing model in any way you can do. That's a business model. But when you talk about the core concept behind which or by the side of which the entire business model is lying, that has to be very sturdy and very, 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 very durable to work in different lines. So these are the four factors which defines whether a model could be a success or not. Challenges beside this is mainly on the operation front that we see. In Taiwan, we don't see those challenges. 8 years back, there were. So 8 years back, Taiwan was in the same situation where India is today. And we had a lot of theft. We had a lot of vandalism of the scooters. So assets were going to be very much disturbed in different ways. People were trying to steal the batteries. People were trying to do damages to the seats. People were trying to steal the helmets. So we got rid of every single thing, whatever is there. We started working more on data. We started working more on sensors, collecting data, collecting feedback on the user driving habit, barring those users from using the vehicle. These are a few of the initiatives that we took in that market. And I'm sure the challenges in India would be very much similar to what we faced over there. And likewise, we're going to also work around something on that level.
So I want to add on to it. So since we talked about last mile connectivity, so I think in the last mile connectivity, rebalancing is also a huge problem. So many of the companies in India are doing that for their operations. I think Wogo is not doing it, right? So but many of the companies are doing it. So in the rebalancing, it's very important to maintain the vehicle very, very easily. But the vehicles that are available right now in the market, like the heavy ones, they weigh around like 100 kgs, so they are very tough to, you know, pick it up again, put it into a vehicle, rebalance it to a high demand location area. So this is one of the big challenge which people in last mile connectivity market are facing. Apart from that, as you just mentioned, vandalism is a big problem in India and in the countries that you operate also. So this is the problem because we are trying to find solution in the already existing products. The already existing products in the market are meant for personal mobility. And this is something we did a lot of brainstorming on. Personal mobility products looks a lot different than compared to it a shared mobility product. Let's take for this example, like in most of the Ola and Uber, we see just two cars, Wagoneer and Swift Desire. There must be a reason for that because those two are the cars which are most suitable for shared mobility, having less maintenance, more life. They are having some, they can earn more on the entire life of the product. So that's what will happen in the shared two-wheeler market also. Like you need to focus on the core values that are generating revenues. Like there are a lot of things that you don't need in a shared mobility product that are there in the personal mobility product. So just remove those components. That's what we are doing. So we are removing those components, adding on the components that are exactly needed in the shared mobility, like the connectivity, the anti-vandalism and anti-theft features. So that's what the solution of these things. And these are definitely the challenges, like vandalism, life is a big challenge, yeah. So like many of the companies who are operating right now by the existing products are not even able to break even because life is a big challenge. Like those products are meant to be driven, like for, if you'll talk about two-wheelers, like average two-wheeler distance that people ride by their two-wheelers is around like 15 kilometers a day. But in the shared mobility, the distance suddenly becomes 100 kilometers a day. And that's a drastic increase. But the personal mobility products are not designed for those particular limits. So
life is a big factor. So the vehicle degrades quickly, and they are not even be able to reach to a break-even point. So, yeah.
This is an extension of that question. I mean, we all recognize that EV is going to have faster adoption going in, but fundamentally, if you look at it at a macro level, there are going to be two options in terms of product development and adoption. Option number one would be to sell the battery with the asset itself, keep the cost of the value high, especially with larger form factors like vehicles, etc., and focus more on building charging infrastructure, whether it's rapid charging, etc. The strategy two, or the other option, is to separate the vehicle from the battery itself and focus more on battery as a service solution and focus more in terms of charging stations. I just like to understand everybody's point of view in terms of where you see the markets going 5-10 years from now. Would it be option A or option B, and why?
Well, so I think it's a chicken and egg problem. Probably it's not, I mean, I don't know, A, B, maybe C, D, E. I mean, yeah. So I think, so the problem is that there are a lot of fundamental issues. I think he mentioned there's a 40,000-50,000 feet view, and then there is probably the ground view. So if you think about it, today there is no standardized electric product in India. If you think about petrol two-wheelers, more or less, you know, the spare parts are here and there interchangeable. I mean, between a TVS, I mean, TVS manufactures most of the spare parts for even Honda and even for TVS as well. though there is difference in, you know, certain things, but there are interoperability between all of these models. However, in an electric two-wheeler, we don't have an ecosystem. Again, I insist on this ecosystem, because the thing is that there is, I mean, after FAME II, I think that only few thousand vehicles have been sold till date. I mean, probably two-wheelers, probably 10,000, 20, I don't know, the very, very small number. India in itself would have sold not more than 2 lakh two-wheelers still in its history. And then you have a bunch of OEMs, electric vehicle OEMs. So then you think about what are the problems, right? So the battery, the size, the casing, the way it is made, the voltage and the separated out. They also, the other thing is that none of them have the money that it takes, right, to create the ecosystem. I mean, Ather is by far the best that I have seen in terms of the product and where they are today, and they have raised a lot of money, but still creation of an ecosystem is a problem for them. So I think no individual player can create it. So for me, I don't know what is the option. For me, it is more like we will discover it. It's a journey that we all have to take. And I think we'll, as he said, maybe, you know, try and create a place where everybody can focus on their efforts together. That's what I think.
I'd like to add to that, in terms of, you know, when we talk about the battery swapping infrastructure that is being built in the country or is proposed to be built, I believe that will not be something, you know, that will grow very big in the future. Because even if you look at it currently, there are... I'll again take the example of Okinawa, because that is what I'm using. The iPraise model, if I talk about, they have a 3.3 kilowatt hour battery, and I am getting 120 kilometers in Dehradun for one charge. So I don't see a personal, you know, individual user having to, you know, swap the battery, you know, during a regular day on, you know, his commute, going to office, coming back, or going out for a movie in the evening. I don't think anybody here, you know, travels more than 120 kilometers per day on a regular basis. So, and the technology obviously is getting better. Lithium-ion batteries are getting produced here in India. Most of the major players are getting into it. Exide, Amaron, you know, lots of others, Toshiba, Denso, and Maruti obviously have a joint venture. So even if you look at it in terms of, you know, the fleet operators, we have been talking to Swiggy, and obviously they're our first customer. So when we talk to their delivery people, what they tell us is that, you know, a typical day consists of a maximum of 130 kilometers, you know, of deliveries. Each delivery is like 5 to 7 kilometers on an average. So even if they do 20 odd deliveries a day, it comes out to, you know, 140 odd kilometers. So we are almost very close to that, you know, range already, where even a delivery person who is, you know, moving around the whole day doesn't need to have a battery swap. So, and apart from that, the other point, of course, is fast charging that, you know, companies like Ankit's are working on. If even as a fleet operator, if I can get, you know, my batteries to go from 0 to 100 in 20 minutes, I really don't see the point of having to invest in another, you know, battery to run my fleet operations also. If it is optimized in a way that, you know, I can have maybe my delivery person on a tea break or even a toilet break, and, you know, by the time he's done, the battery is charged, I don't see a problem.
So I'd just like to, since I'm expected to give the technology answers to this, whatever you do, okay, whether it's battery swapping, whether it's producing your own battery, whether it's connecting up the ecosystem, and the ecosystem is very important. I mean, when I say ecosystem, I mean insurance, I mean spares, I mean, you know, if there's battery swapping, then battery swapping services. I just like to cite one trend that I see, and I think Microsoft is really leading that trend, and not because I'm Microsoft, but for the first time in the world, actually, BMW and Microsoft have partnered to create the world's first open manufacturing platform. What does it mean? That in that manufacturing platform, you'll have all the connected experiences, and any other OEM can actually partake in it. The question is that what happens to the egos that we have as OEMs? Will we use a common platform to create? And obviously, even if you see the better OEMs, they produce multiple models and variants on a single line, right? So that's one. But closer to the home, at the recently concluded annual general meeting of Reliance, Mukesh Ambani actually announced a very strategic alliance with Microsoft. And the whole game plan is that multiple data centers, which will have Azure, and the whole game plan is that there will be free cloud to startups to do their experiments and do all their jigging that they want, right? Actually, it will be. And then, what will it do to transform the entire SMB business, small, medium? Imagine connecting up millions of Kirana shops with simple Kaizala app on the which can help them reorder, which can help them keep their accounts, which can help them get proof of deliveries. What does that do to the last mile transportation industry? How can that get extended to, let's say, Reliance Energy coming up with charging infrastructure? What does it do to the entire ecosystem of smaller players who are trying to grow, who can ride on the Reliance, the Jio Cloud, and have services in every Indian language possible? So I think there are some very, very cool things happening, and great thing. I won't say cool things only, great things happening in our country. It's just that, you know, a couple of you should get together and write to Mukesh Bhai that we want this. De dega aapko.
You know, the original question which you asked regarding the challenge, and I think for me, you know, at this point of time, there is a dangerous trend of an outsider insider to the industry. So if you are in an EV ecosystem, you are not complementing what exists already. So like you said about ecosystem of mechanics and technicians and spare parts, and they already exist. Now the fear to a new player that they will not adopt is wrong. I think this we have to take out. At the same time, I agree there are egos in the automotive industry. It can be. But this is one case where I see it can't be completely separate, that the existing is completely away, insider and outsider. There'll be some player inside which can actually collaborate and cooperate with the outsider, and then only industry become the ultimate. It is still an automotive industry. It's not going to be a new industry we are talking. We are talking about disrupting or innovating within the industry. So I guess somewhere both have to walk and handhold.
Let's disrupt the industry. Let's
not destroy each other.
Exactly. And this is very important. I think if I can take something which you we all should contribute, is not to get to that level that we are destroying is not a disruption. If just for the sake of destroying and we take a credit that, okay, I disrupted by not having a EV subsidy, or somebody said, okay, I disrupted by closing all the IC engine, I think this will be futile for us, at least for our country, where every money, every penny is important. So how will we collaborate and complement? There's always a way. And I think everybody should set up the fear. There's no fear of that they will not adopt. Yes, the question mark is, will all the player will adopt? Will the all the player will have with open arms accept? Is the question.
Okay, thank you so much. I think we're getting signs from there to say that we're going to have to wrap up this session with regards to questions. I still have a lot of interesting questions here, but I think we have just enough time to throw it open to the audience to see if they would like to ask this panel any questions. Please. Can we get a microphone here, please?
Hi. I'm Sumrit from Metro Tires, and it's a very noble thought that Mr. Dasgupta has of, you know, like an open source for all OEMs. But my question to you is, like, in an environment when let's say Royal Enfield is investing in shops which they own, which are like experience centers per se, and they want customers to come in and they want to experience the apparel, they want to experience the feel of the motorbike, etc. How will an open source, how will you attract the kind of people that you want, like the Generation Z, to come to these open source platforms and not really think about the branding exercise because they're CKD kits? And then how do you build the brand is going to be my question.
Okay, first of all, I would avoid that word open source. In technology terms, it's a very different thing. Open source, of course, is open source software. My answer to that is, what is a trend in US, if you see? There are enough and more multi-brand mega dealerships. Okay, now the question is, why hasn't it taken off in India? What does it do to the economics of every contesting OEM? If even if you got a private partnership on to create that, an outsourced brand experience center, so to say, we can have multiple badges. You can have Triumph on one side, Harley on the other. And why is it so necessary? What does Royal Enfield have to fear against a Harley or a Triumph? Why can't they all be in different bays? The customer is king. Customer comes in, makes choices. Let them all vie for that customer in that same place. Save space. The economics can work out even better. And really, in terms of brand experience, if you tell me, is there something so unique about the experience that Royal Enfield can give vis-a-vis a Triumph, except for engineering specifications, maybe? I doubt it. A bike is a bike. You ride a bike. And you ride a CC, right? All that I have heard is, yeah, wind in the hair and, dust in the nose and, you know, that kind of stuff. But, yeah, you can simulate those two with technology. You can throw some dust in your face while you're, you know.
I think I will agree with you that the brand has to be differentiated very clearly. But I also agree with him, there is a possibility of not open source, but modularization. I'll give you examples of, we create a lot of projector modules which can go to a BM or which can go to a two-wheeler, all the power sports, we're actually market leader there. The internal stuff can be the same, which is actually saving your cost. But for the customer, it can be very different. So you can actually, you call it semi-customization. The same modules, you look at in India, example can be, you look at the buses. Now, we are like market leader there with projector modules, but every bus is a different bus. It's possible to create. It's actually a modular approach. You see in the mobile, the towers are basically every competitor is sharing the same tower. So there's a possibility to cooperate and compete, and the brand differentiation is possible to a great extent.
Co-opete is the word, right? So I'm actually, just to add to that point, where is the next generation going to? I'm actually a member of a club or a zone called Makers Asylum. I don't know. There's one in Delhi, I guess, also, somewhere. Have you heard of Maker's Asylum? Anybody? So Maker's Asylum is a place of, let's say, 5,000 square feet, where you pay a membership, and you go and make stuff. So there's a guy right now building a buggy. He's not using a CKD kit. He's actually cutting metal, shaping it, getting the engine tuned, putting it in the chassis. There are other people playing around with, having drip irrigation on a connected app, and how do you do aquaponics at home or vertical farming at home. There are people doing woodwork. So like that, can you not have maker zones? Where I said, if you gave me CKD kits and if you ultimately certified that I have fixed my electric bike well and it's good fit to travel, just imagine the involvement with the brand. A biker who really loves his bike would love to spend time on the bike, like a car, right? So I think we are not, again, I'm going back to the same point, we are not tapping that DNA that is there, latent, and yet we don't want to capitalize on it. So I am all for multi-brand centers. It does nothing to undermine a brand versus the other. It proves the economics, and let there be competition. Let a consumer come in and then decide which is the best bike for me.
No, but my point would be
that... you know what? We are running out of time, sir. No counter questions. We have time for one more question. And if there isn't, then we'll come back to you. And you can welcome to take it offline. Yeah. Thank you. Any other last question?
Is there any market that could exist in the rural segment for electric vehicles? Do you see that there could be a market for electric vehicles? And none of the panels till now have spoken about it. The markets that
we
have spoken...
What's the potential of EVs in the rural sector?
Even rentals as well. Because
So I can answer that for shared mobility. We have present, not per se rural, but tier 2, tier 3 markets. I think it's there is a huge potential out there in the tier 2, tier 3 as well. Because when we talk about e-commerce, all of the startups, they basically go after the top 10 cities in India and all the creme de la creme, the first 2 crores or the next 5, 6 crores of population. However, mobility is universal. Mobility is beyond anything because people need to move whichever city they are in. So if you think about it, Bangalore is a developed city according, if you compare within India. And Bangalore has around 6,500 buses, talking about public infrastructure, and moves around, 5.5 million people a day. However, if you think about a Hubli or a Mangalore, you will have few hundred buses, but the population of a Hubli is probably more than 1 million, right? So now, which means that if Bangalore's public infrastructure is broken because lesser number of buses are available, then Hubli or Mangalore or any other city like that, which is 1 million plus but smaller, imagine the plight there. So as far as two-wheeler shared mobility is concerned, I think there is a huge market to kill even in the tier 2, tier 3 cities, right? So, and that's what I think makes it very special for shared mobility because even the top 7 cities have not been killed by the existing players today because all of us are pretty small. I think in the next 5-10 years with technology and revolution in electric and so on and so forth, I think shared mobility is going to be very, very big even in the rural markets and it'll solve a real, real problem for people at there as well at the right price point, right? At 5-6 rupees a kilometer, nothing comes closer because the cost structure of the business is so low that you can still price out everybody at 5-6 rupees a kilometer. So I think that is why it would work really well and at scale up.
Okay. I think that's all the time we have. I want to thank everybody for taking time out and coming here and also thank the audience for putting up with us and listening to our questions. And I think this is it for the day and I'd like to just take that over. Thank everybody.